Good evening. Today's liturgy celebrates the 28th Sunday of Ordinary Time, and our Mass is being offered for Janine Ullman by Wilf Larrabee and Vera Krenza by Gaetan and Carla Demaray. Please stand to welcome our presider tonight, Monsignor Pat.
Here the love of Christ shall end divisions. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place.
Let us build a house where prophets speak and words are strong.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to everybody here. Good to have everybody here on this Thanksgiving weekend. And it's good to go to church while we can go to church. Because we don't know anymore, do we? So be appreciative of the fact that we can still gather. My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy. You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy. You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. May your grace, O Lord, we pray, at all times go before us and follow after, and make us always determined to carry out good works. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrows, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people. He will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation, for the hand of the Lord will rest on this mountain. The word of the Lord. I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, I know what it is to have little, and I know what it is to have plenty. In any and all circumstances, I have learned the secret of being well fed and of going hungry, of having plenty and of being in need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. In any case, it was kind of you to share my distress. My God will fully satisfy every need of yours according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord. Gospel acclamation. Hallelujah, hallelujah. May the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ enlighten the eyes of our heart, that we might know the hope to which we are called. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Once more, Jesus spoke to the chief priests and the Pharisees in parables. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet to his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, "Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet." But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, "The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore into the streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet." Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, "Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?" And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, "Bind him hand and foot and throw him out into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen." The Gospel of the Lord.
So basically, we have last week's gospel with a twist. It's very, very similar. A different kind of environment, but similar message for the most part. It's the twist that makes this different. So let's go back. When you look at the parables, you have to follow them in order. This is the third one that deals with the kingdom of heaven. And it's the third time that it starts off with Jesus spoke to the chief priests, elders. This time as chief priests and Pharisees. So this is aimed first and foremost at them to start. So he says, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son." Now, if you know the Jewish scripture, Isaiah has used the wedding banquet to describe the messianic kingdom, the arrival of the Messiah. So the Pharisees and the chief priests would have picked up, we know this illustration, we know this image, we know how it's been used. Then he said he sent his slaves to call those who had been invited. Now, the first invitees, as was mentioned last week, the first invitees are the Jewish people. But they would not come. Well, wait a minute now. A lot of the Jewish people came to the wedding banquet. So this has to be those members of the Jewish kingdom that somehow or another refused the invitation the way it was written. Again, he sent other slaves, and they still would not come. And they have excuses. "My oxen, my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready." They made light of it and went away. One to his farm, another to a business. The rest seized his slaves and mistreated them, killed them. That sounds awful lot like last week's, doesn't it? But they have been given a personal invitation by the king, and they have turned it down. That is a slap in the face. The king just doesn't just invite anybody. He chooses who to invite, and they don't think it's important enough to pay heed. And they refuse the invitation. The king was enraged, and Matthew has this annoying habit that many of his parables end up in violence. Getting even. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. That's kind of a nasty reprisal for refusing an invitation, but it's done for emphasis, not for literal translation. It's done saying, you know, you best pay attention here because the consequences could be severe. And not because God's going to do it, but you're going to do it to yourself. If you refuse this invitation, there are consequences for your actions. And you will dictate them, not me. So then when they refuse, in the old King James Version, I used to like this translation, this one says he went into the main streets. I remember the old King James Version. He went into the highways and byways. I was never quite sure what a byway was, but it sounded good. Highways and byways. And invite everyone to the wedding banquet. Now, if you're going out into the streets to invite everybody, what are the chances that these people will be naturally well-dressed? Who wears their wedding banquet clothes and Sunday go to meet in clothes every day? Well, nowadays, yeah, that's the way it works, but it didn't work that way back then. So they gather up all these people, and there's some of them it says good or bad, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. Now, wasn't that nice of the king that these people probably who never had this kind of opportunity in their lives are now going to be able to attend this wedding banquet of the king? That which was reserved for these other people who did not consider it important enough, they get the opportunity. Now, if we end the story there, this is marvelous, isn't it? But we got this little addendum that the church gives us the opportunity not to say it, because to there, Jesus looks good. But then comes this one. This part here was the part that my mother really did not like. And one day when I was going for supper over at her place, she had read this parable, and she said, there's something wrong here. If they're going out to the highways and the byways and collecting people up off the street, how could the guy possibly have a wedding garment? And the king comes into the thing and sees the guy without a wedding garment. Well, of course he's not going to have, I'm quoting my mother. Of course he's not going to have a wedding garment. They picked him up off the street. How could he possibly have a wedding garment? That doesn't sound very fair. I said, well, that's very observant of you, mother, because it doesn't sound fair, especially if we don't understand the custom of the day. If they're going out into the highways and byways, they're leaving town. If you were in town, it was expected that you would clean up and wear your best vestments and come to the wedding garment, come to the wedding banquet. But if you were royalty putting on a wedding banquet and people were coming from far away, most often or quite often walking, they were going to get dirty on the way to your place. And your job was to provide the water to clean up and the clean vestment, the wedding garment. That's where it gets its name. The king would supply it. That's what you wore. So when the king comes into this hall, and this one guy would have stood out like a sore thumb, and he goes over to him and he says, how'd you get in here without a wedding robe? Now, the gospel says he was speechless. Now, why is he speechless? Because he knows what he's done. He walked in and somebody offered him a wedding garment, and he said something like, oh, I don't know. Let's see if we can put it into 21st century terms. If I'm not good enough the way I am, then too bad. I'm wearing this. They can take me the way I am. And that's not a reply that the king wants, because the wedding garment is Jesus in this story. He's the wedding garment, and you have refused him. What makes you think you get to stay? And so he's bound up hand and foot and tossed out, because he had a choice and refused it out of his own stubbornness or his pride, whatever reasons, he refused it. Now, if we translate that to 2020, can you see where this is a warning for us? We are all the invitees. You and I have all been invited. It's part of our baptism. We've been invited to the banquet. This celebration today is a foretaste of the heavenly banquet. It just prepares us for the great banquet in heaven. And you and I are invited. But what happens if we don't take the invitation seriously? That it's not important enough, or that we can be lackadaisical, or we can just poo-poo it. I love that expression, poo-poo. But what happens if we, like the first group of invitees, don't take it seriously enough? We have all our reasons, the farm and the business and other things more important to do, golfing, holidays, all these other things that we designate as being more important. What happens to us if they become more important? Do we get a better fate than the other people in the story? No, we don't. Then, if we do enter into the wedding banquet, and we think we can do this, I love this, our way. You know that song that Paul Anka wrote? You know, Frank Sinatra sang it, "I did it my way," and everybody's proud of that. People sing that with pride, "I did it my way." Okay, you can live this life your way. You think God's going to be happy with that one? God wants us to live this life His way. And we best hope it matches up. We've got a lot of leeway, and there's a lot of room to maneuver. But at the end of the day, we best do this His way. We don't get to design our way of getting into heaven. That's been designed for us. We find that in the person of Christ. So we either do this His way, or we can see how well it works out when I can stand before God and say, you know, "Thanks for the invitation. I did it my way." I have the stinging suspicion this is the reply. "Congratulations. Now I will do it my way." And we might not like what His way is, because we know what His way is. We're not dumb. We've been raised in the knowledge and the understanding of what Jesus wants. If we turn that down and we refuse to say, "I don't need to do it that way. I just need to look after me." What makes us think that the end result will be so much better? Again, this parable is one of those cautionary tales. It's another one of those parables that tells us, straighten up, fly right. Because what we do, how we behave, has consequences. Now I sound like my dad. But what we do with our lives has consequences. Our decisions have ramifications. And we better make sure that the decisions we make are those that line up with the heart and the mind of God. Because the end result, if we don't, is not pretty. Now I sound, remember those people that we used to get during Lent? The passionate fathers used to come to preach retreats, and they'd always preach fire and brimstone. Well, everybody hated them, but they went and listened. And we oftentimes got upset with their message. But parts of it is still valid. Parts of it are still valid. It's not what we should focus on, but we can't throw it away either.
Our profession of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Trusting in the Lord of life, who calls us by name, let us turn to God in prayer.
For all members of the church, may we answer the call of the Lord in our lives to serve him and others in love and humility. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For nations that are overwhelmed by outbreaks of infectious disease and epidemics, may they receive necessary medications and support to care for the ill. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the elderly and their caregivers, may they know the care and compassion of God and live in dignity and comfort. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray that by the virtue of baptism, the laity, especially women, may participate more in areas of responsibility in the church. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We're all gathered here and thanking God for all that we have received. May we be blessed with generosity to use our gifts and talents for the good of others. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our parish community, especially for the sick, for those who are grieving the loss of a loved one, for the lonely, for those who have no one to pray for them, and for all the intentions which we hold in our hearts. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God, our shepherd and guide, through the parables your Son Jesus teaches us the secrets of your kingdom. Hear our prayers that in meditating on your word, we might grow ever closer to you. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
This is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground. For the Lord is present, and where he is holy. This is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground. For the Lord is present, and where he is holy. These are holy hands. He's given us holy hands. He works through these hands, and so these hands are holy. These are holy hands. He's given us holy hands. This is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground. For the Lord is present, and where he is holy. This is holy ground. We're standing. Thank you.
long time ago, I saw a plaque on the wall at a friend's house, and it stuck with me. And on that plaque, it said, "When you're up to your waist in alligators, sometimes it is difficult to remember that the initial objective was to drain the swamp." When we find ourselves in the midst of difficult times, one of the most difficult things to do sometimes is to push off the negativity and try to find positive things to say and do. It also has a tendency, when we focus on the negativity, to take away our gratefulness. So one of the things we need to remember on this Thanksgiving weekend is to be grateful. We may not have everything the way we want it, but it's not as if we don't have anything. We still have friends. Well, most of us. We still have family. We still have people who care. My father used to say, "A roof over top of your head and food in your stomach." We're doing better than a lot of other people in this world. So if that's what we want to focus on, is what we lost and what we don't have, then we'll never be grateful again. So let's take a moment to try and remember what we have to be grateful for. And try to get rid of some of the negativity. Pray, friends, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May your grace, accept, O Lord, the prayers of your faithful, with the sacrificial offering, that through these acts of devotedness we may pass over to the glory of heaven, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by his birth he brought renewal to humanity's fallen state, and by his suffering canceled out our sins. By his rising from the dead, he has opened the way to eternal life, and by ascending to you, O Father, he has unlocked the gates of heaven. And so, with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim: Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The first proclamation, the mystery of faith. We proclaim. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Serge, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, O Lord. We pray that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, St. Anthony of Padua, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we wait the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Lamb of God, behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall be healed. Don't get worried. I give you thanks, O Lord, for this parish that I've been blessed to work in for 21 years, for the staff that I've had for most of that 21 years, for my friends that I've made here, for my family. Though they're not perfect, they've still been very good to me, as of the people in this parish. I consider myself a very fortunate human being. I've been having trouble lately reading the sacramentary, and so I thought maybe I had to get my glasses fixed. So I went to the optometrist, and we had he did some tests. He found out that I have cataracts. Just throw in one more thing, it's okay. I told my brother, now does anybody here remember Little Abner? It's going to date you. But Little Abner, there was a character in that Little Abner comic strip that had a cloud over top of his head, black cloud. And wherever he went, the clouds followed him. And so my brother said, I think you're like that character. I said, nah, I'm not. He says, well, you don't have a whole lot of luck. I said, yeah, but that cloud was black. Mine's white. I don't let this stuff get me down at the end of the day. And one of the easiest solutions for me to remind myself that I'm still very fortunate is to go back to 1982 to a hospital room where a doctor walked in and told me, you're going to die. And you know what? That's 38 years ago. Apparently he was wrong. And I've been working on the gravy train for 38 years. So if you can't be grateful for that and all the things that have happened in those years that God has allowed me to be alive, then you're one very dissatisfied human being. I'm lucky. I am very lucky. And I have been blessed. Very blessed. This parish has been one of the greatest blessings in my life for over 21 years. I have more than enough to be grateful for. Let us pray. Now, Lord, if you could just improve my golf game. We entreat your majesty most humbly, O Lord, that as you feed us with the nourishment which comes from the most holy body and blood of your Son, so you may make us sharers of his divine nature, who lives and reigns forever and ever. The Lord be with you. And have a great Thanksgiving weekend. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
And mercy abound. May all join in one grateful song, that our words be true and our hearts be strong.
joined all as one. What a gift to share in all that God has done. What a gift to be celebrating goodness and grace. What a gift to rejoice in this hope.